afternoon, folks. You are all very welcome to the Rock of Cashel. My name is Magella and I'll be your tour guide for the next 35 to 40 minutes. Now, before we start the tour, I do have a brief safety announcement. Now, some of the doorways are a little bit low. Now, this doesn't pose a problem for me, but if you are slightly taller, just be careful as you're entering some of the buildings. As well as that, some of the pathways are a little bit uneven in the graveyard, so just be careful in certain areas. Now, before I talk about any of the buildings on site, I'd just like to give you a brief overview of the history of the Rock of Cashel. Now, the history of the site here stretches right back to the 4th and 5th centuries, when it was originally the seat of the Kings of Munster. Now, I don't know how familiar some of you will be with Irish geography, but Ireland as a country is divided into four provinces: Ulster in the north, Leinster in the east, Connacht in the west, and Munster here in the south. And this was basically the seat of power for this province. Now, at that time, Ireland would have been ruled by what are known as clans or tribes. And the first clan to be associated with the site was the Oannach clan, and their family name was McCarthy. The first king who founded the kingship here at Cashel, his name was Conall Kirk. Now, the McCarthys reigned here in power for over 500 years, until they were ousted from power by another clan called the Dalcosh, who came from County Clare. And their family name was O'Brien. And one of its members was perhaps one of the most famous High Kings of Ireland, and his name was Brian Boru. Now, he became King of Munster in 978, and he became High King over all of Ireland in 1002. And he was the first Munster King to achieve this. He was killed at the Battle of Clontarf in 1014 when the Irish defeated the Vikings. Now, it was his great-grandson, Murtagh O'Brien, who was to change the history of the Rock of Cashel forever, because at a meeting here in 1101, he handed the site over to the church. Now, this may seem like a very strange thing to do, but at the time, it was a very clever political manoeuvre. The church in Ireland at that time was gaining huge power. So to ensure his place within this power, he gave the site to the church, and he also made sure that his family's old enemies, the McCarthys, could never again regain power because he had given away their ancient royal seat. So at that point, the site went from a site of political power to a site of religious power. And what we have here today are the remains of a collection of religious buildings that were built at different stages. None of the buildings that would have been here in the time of the kings exist today. Now, the earliest buildings date to the 12th century, which is the round tower that's located on the opposite side of the site, and Cormac's Chapel, which is the building with the distinctive yellow stone you may have noticed as you come up the hill. Now, some of you may already have been on the tour of the chapel at 2, some of you may be going at 3, but usually for those of you who have paid the general admission, I will be finishing the tour outside the chapel and explaining as much as I can about its significance from the exterior. Now, we've one 13th century building, which is the cathedral that's located opposite us here. And we have two 15th century buildings, which is the tower house that was added to the back of the cathedral. It's where the archbishop would have lived when he lived on site. And the building we're standing in now, which is called the Hall of the Vicar's Choral. And this is where the choir would originally have lived. Now, the site here continued as a religious site right up until the 18th century. And it was also the seat of an archbishop, and it still remains an archdiocese today, the Archdiocese of Cashel and Emily. But over time, it got very difficult and very expensive for the town of Cashel to maintain a site like this. So it was decided that cathedral status will be put on St. John's in the town, and it was also decided that the archbishop would have a new residence in the town. And he lived in what is now known today as the Cashel Palace Hotel, which is located on the main street of Cashel. It's quite a distinctive building in the centre of the town, and at the moment it's undergoing extensive refurbishment. Now, at that point, the site here was basically abandoned and it was left to rack and ruin. And this continued right up until the 19th century, when it was decided that important religious ruins like the Rock of Cashel would be taken into state care. This became one of the first national monuments we would have had in Ireland. It's the first monument that had any kind of conservation work carried out, and this was done in the 19th century. Now, we're starting our tour in the upper level of the Vicar's Choral. Now, this building was constructed in 1420 by Archbishop Richard O'Keeden to house a group known as the Vicar's Choral. And this was basically the choir that would have sang in the cathedral during the ceremonies. Now, buildings like this were fairly common in England and France, but this is the only one of its type in Ireland, so it makes it very unique. Now, the Vicar's Choral were quite a select group, a group of only 8 members, all male, a mixture of clergy and laity. And they were considered very important within the town of Cashel. They were given titles and lands by the Archbishop. Now, the lay members who were part of the choir, if they were married or if they had families, their families lived in the town of Cashel. They did not live up here with the choir. Now, the layout of the building where we're standing here would have been their living and dining room area. The smaller room that you would have passed through out there would originally have been their kitchen area. Downstairs, where our museum section is, where the original St. Patrick's Cross is, would have been a storage area. And they would have slept in the room to the back of us here, where our AV theatre is today. That would originally have been their dormitory. Now, above the fireplace here, we have what is known as the seal of the Vicar's Choral. Now, you'll see the members of the choir are represented there. Now, this is a reproduction of the original seals. Now, the original seals were much smaller. They were only as big as the palm of your hand. And they worked in the same way as a credit card would today. Now, if any of the group needed to buy anything or if they needed to purchase anything within the town, they would present the seal and the bill would be sent to the Archbishop at the end of the year. Now, with any system like this, it was said that it had been abused. Members of the group tended to give copies of the seals to their families and friends. So one year when the Archbishop got the bill, he got a bit of a shock. But it is one of the earliest cases of credit card fraud we would have had in Ireland. So for the sake of the Archbishop, the system was then changed after that. Now below the seal, we have the fireplace, which is original to this building. And you'll see there's an inscription here on the left-hand side. Now the E here and the E here represent Edward or Edmund, which were fairly common names at the time. The S represents Saul and the H, Hackish or Hayden. Now the inscription in its entirety reads, Edmund Saul and Edmund Hackett had me made. Now at the time it was very usual for stonemasons to sign or signature their work, basically to differentiate themselves from any other craftsmen. Now stonemasons' marks are fairly common in buildings of this type. They're not necessarily words, sometimes they're pictures or symbols. And you will see them in a lot of buildings of the period. Now, all of the furniture that you see here is 16th century. It was purchased at an auction in Adair Manor in County Limerick. And it's meant to be representative of what would originally have been here. The designs would have been fairly similar. The tapestry is 17th century and it's Flemish in origin. And it's meant to represent King Solomon meeting the Queen of Sheba. Now, tapestries were not only for decoration, but they also provided heat and insulation into rooms. Because as you can imagine, buildings of this type would have been very, very cold. Now, there was a belief back then that only God could create something perfect. So it was very usual for weavers to deliberately put mistakes into their tapestries. Now, some of the mistakes that have been identified, if you look at the lady at the end here, she's got quite a six-pack for a woman. She's got a very muscular torso. The hands are also slightly unusual. The two of the figures are stuck together, the one that the king is holding towards himself, and also the one extended by the queen. Now the border also does not come the whole way around the tapestry. Now this could be because it might be part of a larger tapestry. Sometimes what we see hanging on castle walls and buildings like this today, sometimes was part of a much larger piece. Now above the tapestry, there's an inscription with the year 1982. Now this is the only restored building on site and it was restored between 1975 and 1982. Now while you were down in reception where you purchased your ticket, if you'd looked up at the roof, you would have seen carvings of stone heads. Now these are not historical figures associated with the site. These are people who were responsible for the restoration of this building. And their heads were carved up there to demonstrate how you would be recognised in the 15th century if you donated time, money or expertise to buildings of this type. Now every effort was made to make this as accurate a restoration as possible. Now the walls that you see are original. The white colour that you see on the walls is a white lime wash and it was designed to reflect as much light as possible into the room. It also served to limit the growth of mould or damp because buildings of this type would have been very, very wet. Now the roof needed to be restored. Now there is not one nail holding this roof together. It's held together by wooden pegs which are known as dowel rods. All of the colours that you see there, they're all natural colours. They're derived from plant dyes, and again, it's very similar to what they would have had during this period. Now the carvings of the angels represent the fact that this was a choir house, and they're holding different coats of arms of different archbishops who would have been here at certain points. Now, as with all roofs of the 15th century, there is said to be a Viking or Scandinavian influence in this roof, which the craftsmen have endeavoured to create. Because it is said, if you could imagine, if the roof was turned the other way, it looks like the inside of a Viking ship. Mm-hmm. Now, folks, we're going to exit from the right-hand side here, and we're going to stop briefly at St. Patrick's Cross.